Okay, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining. Today is our first session of this academic year with a paper presentation from Florian Witkemper and Kevin Naimi, who are going to take it away and introduce themselves and also share your slides, right? Okay, so without further ado, thanks everyone so much for joining. And Kevin, please start sharing.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Monica, for orchestrating all of this. And my name is Kevin Naimi. I am a professor at the Université Laval in Quebec City. I'm a sociologist, sociology of education, philosophy of education. And Florian, I'll let you give a little.
Yes, thank you. I'm Florian Weitkemper. I'm an assistant professor in Freiburg in Germany, and I did my PhD in the context of sociology of education in between or close to general education. So, as our presentation today, authority, vulnerability, and inequality are important topics in my research. So maybe we can already start.
Yeah, I wanted to maybe give just like a 5 second. So actually, Florian reached out to me just through email, out of the blue. I don't know where he came across me. And our research interests are extremely aligned. And so what we're actually presenting today is a bit of a project based on his work largely, but that we are working on together now. And I'm developing sort of a branch of it. And so I invited Florian here into this relational sociology group because his work deals with so many common themes. And so what we're presenting today is sort of the beginnings of something that we're working on. If you're interested in some of the core elements of this presentation, Florian has actually published on the question of doing and undoing authority. He has an article that is available that came out of his research, and that a part of this presentation today will really be drawing from that research. So that's something that's definitely available. And if that's I think that kind of covers all of the all of, so I'll share my screen and we could jump in. Let's do it. You see the right slides, right? Okay, perfect. So what we decided to call the topic presentation today is relational authority and the problem of vulnerability in the classroom. And with that, I got a notification right when I started speaking. With that topic, it's what we're really going to be looking at today. So I'm going to be starting with the first part, where we're really going to be talking about some of the theoretical and conceptual dimensions of this theme, relational authority. What does it mean to think of authority as a relational process? How relational authority applies and is manifested within education, and also non-relational versions of what authority looks like. And then Florian is going to continue in the second part, actually outlining his study, the framework that he used, looking in much more detail at a case study. And then we're going to wrap up on some reflections about the importance of authority and how through processes of authority, through relational processes, certain types of inequalities, injustices, and questions of power end up getting reproduced, translated, or maybe even misnamed as for example, good or bad student, or and I think that that might be something the paper that that Florian has published is all about doing and undoing authority, and it's very much about that dynamic. And so, if you have any questions at any point, please raise your hand. Feel free to jump in. There's no problem with that. Okay, so to start, I wanted to look at the idea of the relationship between authority and power, So the question of what does it mean when you say authority? It's a very sort of broad concept that has a lot of implications. And really at the heart of this presentation is the claim that authority is absolutely fundamental, not only to education, but to how we define what education is. So who retains power in the pedagogical relationship? who has voice, who has the right to intervene. All these kinds of questions end up being really front and center of what it means to engage in education itself. And as many of you already know for sure, central questions in social justice education deal exactly with this dynamic, the relationship between the teacher and the student, and the way that power gets practiced in the classroom. The argument that we're bringing is that many of the problems in education today are directly or indirectly related to this question of authority and the way that authority gets attributed. Standardized approaches in education tend to systematize a very particular notion of authority, which in this presentation we're going to be calling monological authority. And this is an idea that I'm borrowing from the philosopher Charles Bingham, who works on this topic. And the monological authority, I'm going to unpack exactly what that means. But in this view of authority, teachers have authority while students are the subjects of such authority. And so there's a very imbalanced relationship here in that point of view. And so this sort of prevalent notion, really, this is in some respects the way that authority is conceptualized by definition in standardized schooling, because we end up creating a formal official curriculum. And then authority ends up being basically the practice of transmitting that curriculum, and it comes with all kinds of implications. And so this idea of authority that's very common is very much based on, we've talked about this in different contexts in this group for sure, but it's very much based on the idea of a substance ontology. So that in this view, authority is a thing. It's something that someone has, and that ends up having a particular consequence on how we think about authority. So in this quote, for example, authority is usually construed as a possession to which one who lacks power either succumbs or does not succumb. And so this idea of monological authority, this idea of a substantialist view of authority, it takes authority to be unidirectional. So in this case, it's teacher to student. And I think also it's important to think about, and we may not necessarily frame it this way, but at the really fundamental level, the basis of this version of authority is a conflict base. The idea is that the person who has authority can use something like discipline as a way of maintaining, guaranteeing, reinforcing. And so there's an element here that maybe sounds like a bit like the Weberian, that the state is the entity that basically controls the use of violence in a society. That's what we, and so in this, it's a similar idea here. And I think that it might be easy to not necessarily frame it in these terms, but monological authority tends to have this an element of this dimension. And it ends up also then carrying with it a particular pedagogy. And I think this is where so many of the problems emerge in the context of how we talk about authority and power in the classroom, because that pedagogy ends up being where something in what counts as good education is all about control, obedience. It's about maximizing teacher control. And also what ends up coming from that is a very particular definition of what a child is, a good child, the right child. And so in childhood studies, this is a big theme. It's a big area of debate. And being a sort of a good child in this sort of mass education context often means being obedient, being more docile, all of those kinds of things that are very much animated by not children's interests, but actually by the systemic requirements that we need in order to be efficient. And so I think that all of these things sort of nest into different versions of authority and different ways of approaching the relationships in the classroom. And one example, I'm going to just give a little bit of an example from actually Florian's own research, and then Florian, I think, will come back a bit later as well. One example is this notion that, okay, well, teachers want more authority. And so in the context of his research, and now I'm speaking for Florian, and please, Florian, you can jump in here, because I was not a part of this research. So I'm just drawing on an example that he had in his paper. That I find very interesting, and then I'll let you see if you have anything to add on this point. But in his field notes, Florian was taught one of the things that he mentions here is that would you like to read this, Florian? You can read your own voice.
Yeah, sure, I can do it. On my way out of the school, I met Miss Hanneburt. She tells me in front of the school building that she wants more authority. I ask her to elaborate. She explained that she wants the pupil to do what I want. She's desperate and draws comparisons to other colleagues. She wanted to create a set of rules to which she could now simply always refer, as she had great disciplinary difficulties with the pupils.
Thank you. And so I think that in a very concrete way, it really illustrates, for one thing, it illustrates this idea of a substantialist or a monological approach to authority. So there is really a zero-sum game effect here. Teacher authority implies the disempowerment of the student in the classroom, that one person's authority ends up requiring less authority from the other. And so this is very much a hallmark of a substantialist type of approach. And I also think that that presents well the element of conflict that might exist here. The other one that I wanted to say, and I think that as ethnographers, it's extremely important to say these kinds of things and to be aware of it. This example here, I think with Mrs. Hanabeth, for example, it's important to recognize that this is not a personal desire exclusively. Ms. Hanabeth is a member of a social system that has particular requirements of her. And so in a way, this desire, this want for more authority, ends up being engendered in teachers by their role in the classroom. They need to do things at a particular pace. They need to do things, they need to make proofs of what they're doing. There's all kinds of social and systemic conditions put on teachers. And one thing that that also does, and this is where we're going to tie it in the last part, is that this idea of authority tends to really move vulnerability out of the classroom. It's really about efficiencies. We put the process of efficiency much more at the center, and the entire emotional context of learning often can be very much devalued. And so all of these things can be seen in some respects as part of this particular stance towards the authority that exists in the classroom. And so in thinking about some of the relationship between this idea, yes, Essek.
Yeah, thank you. Just a very quick question. When is this field note conducted and where and at which level of education? Thank you.
I will answer now. Yeah.
Ah, sorry.
So it
yeah,
was
yeah, yeah.
2013. It was in third graders, and what was the last
the location?
The location. So it's in the south of Germany, in a bigger city called Stuttgart.
Okay, thank you. It's very fascinating. I find so many experience that I could see from back home. So it's just, yeah, thank you. Yeah,
absolutely. And I think that in Florian's part, he's going to provide much more of the context specifically around the study that we're going to tie all of this into. And so to come back to just this idea of this particular conception of authority and the idea of empowerment and the idea of power in the classroom, I think this way of thinking about authority tends to present major challenges for what we call empowerment, the process of giving voice, giving power, relinquishing control, all of these kinds of things. It can take on many different forms. I just wanted to give some examples. So in one way, it negates the dialogical core of what education ideally can be among humans. And this is one thing that Paulo Freire talks about extensively. These models of authority tend to situate students as relatively voiceless, obviously not completely, but relatively speaking, the power relation is much more focused on teachers. It presumes and also reproduces what Biesta calls the basic asymmetry of this sort of standardized type of educational approach. So teachers deserve more authority because their claims to such authority is based on being full and complete. Children are incomplete. So there are all kinds of connotations to how this idea of authority gets put together and practiced. And my argument is basically that all told, this model, this way of thinking about power, authority in the classroom creates a very long list of, I'm calling them educational imbalances, but it could be injustices, discriminations of any number of things. And we'll touch on some of those, I think, in the second part. It undermines the democratic, the creative, the participative. My research specifically looks at creativity in the context of education, and I think creativity is something that also has an important part here. And so to sort of end my part here, this first part, so what does it mean to think about a relational approach to authority? So like a relational approach, it primarily aims to redistribute and equalize agency, control, power within the pedagogical relationship. So put very, very simply, this can foreground, this would, for one, foreground the capacity of young people to make important key decisions about their life, about their learning in the classroom. So real decisions, not simply trivial types of choices, choices about how they might approach learning, how they might think about what they want to do with their educational process. And it displaces the teacher from the center. And so I know that we talk a lot about student-centered learning, but what it means here is it gives power to students as well. And so so this idea of displacing the teacher from the center, it really has a lot to do with redefining how we think of expertise in the educational space. It's being an expert is not necessarily being the one that has final say or necessarily being the person that has control over. Being an expert means that you act maybe more as a steward or more as a, and so there are some rather significant changes that could come from a relational conception of authority in this view. And finally, I think that this ties into many of the social justice themes, placing compassion and dignity at the center of the educational process is something that I think would be very important from a relational view of authority. And so now tying this into the next part that we're going to be, the relationship between authority and vulnerability. So as mentioned earlier, this monological view of authority ultimately undermines the space for vulnerability in learning. It ends up making, in the standardized approach, what ends up happening is that we end up having a space that's very much about standards, about efficiencies, and it ends up often crystallizing certain kinds of power relationships that are very problematic. These crystallizations, the way that the standardized space works, it tends to disproportionately have a negative impact on students from marginalized populations or students from outside of the dominant population where things are happening, because that tends to be how these things work. And in this view, a relational view of authority really would require us to embrace the vulnerability in the classroom. It's hard to do that in the standardized-based schooling context, where a vulnerability is unknowns. It presents us with unknowns. It presents us with slowdowns. It requires the personal ability to open up and those kinds of things. We can't, in this view, cling to a model of education that reproduces the power imbalances so common between the teacher and the student. And this is another quote from Charles Bingham that I liked so much. Both students and teachers must experience vulnerability in a healthy educational process. So that sort of was to set some context for what's to come in the next part. And then the next part, Florian's contribution will be looking at his study, where he will be exploring the doing and the undoing of authority in the classroom. And the different ways in which enactments of authority in education and this unwillingness to account for vulnerabilities might contribute to the reproduction of social inequalities, and examples how that might take place. So I hand it off to you, Florian.
Thank you so much. Shall I share the screen now, or do you want to proceed?
You could share it, or I could change slides for you. It's as you wish. Yeah. I think it would be easier if you shared.
Yeah, might be.
You have notes there.
Yes.
Sure. We will do a quick stop and then. Okay.
Is it working, or? Oh, there it is.
The only pity, Is that I cannot see my notes. Oh, sorry, Kevin, might it be possible that you share the screen, then I can have
Sure,
a
sure. Yeah, you
button.
can. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, like that. You can
Sorry.
follow you.
Yeah.
You can
Okay.
follow your notes on the slide there. Okay.
Thanks.
Yeah.
So yeah, some notes or comments on the German school system, because I researched the elementary school, and in or the primary school in Germany, children are divided according to putative performance level after the fourth class, and they are divided into different types of secondary schools. So you can see them here on the slide. There is the highest secondary school, which is called in Germany Gymnasium. Then you have the secondary school, which is called Realschule. This is the red one. And you have the lower secondary school, Werkrealschule, and somehow a track which combines all these three schools. This is the Gesamtschule, and then you have a special track, a special school system. And I was interested in the processes of categorization and selection, as well as teachers associated as activities in the primary school. And therefore, it was in my interest to have a look on the practice in daily school life. And maybe you can switch, Kevin, to the next slide. So my methodology is, maybe you can just make old slide, then it's easier, I guess. Thanks. So my objective was, what is the teacher's role in the transformation of social differences in educational inequalities? Therefore, I observed at two schools once or twice a week, four different teachers over the course of 8 months. And in addition, I conducted guided interviews with teachers and ethnographic interviews with teachers and pupils. And I collected all available artifacts, such as grades, transitional recommendations, or also I used a pupil questionnaire to gain insights into the social demographics. For example, I used the family affluence scale. How many books do you have at home? Questions like this, which pupils who are like 9 years could answer. And to analyze these data, I combined the grounded theory and a sequent analysis method, which is called the addressing concept. It's a lot about the framing of a situation and how the teacher or the pupils address each other in this situations, so especially in these protocols. Meanwhile, I had different perspectives or layers of social inequalities. For example, in the field protocols, I tried to work out or reconstruct powerful difference practices related to representations of the pupils on the part of the teacher through the interviews. Furthermore, I could take an interpretations and attributions of the ethnographer, as I also have like ideas about the pupils and so on. So therefore, I analyzed my memos and observation protocols. And finally, I triangulated it with self-assessments of the pupils' social backgrounds. And especially I was interested in the activities of teachers, and thus I focused on the methods of participating, my protocols of participating observation in the analysis. Especially, I try to analyze thickly described passages or very dense passages and use the sequence analyze technique to work out different practices. And could you make next slide, Kevin? Thanks. So what is meant by authority, and especially this doing undoing authority? I understood, as Kevin already mentioned, authority in a relational way, and therefore authority in my I use the notion of recognized leadership from Schaefer and Thompson. So recognized leadership would mean that you can have a look on the practical on the interaction between teachers and pupils and how leadership is recognized in this kind of contexts. This was why I was analyzing levels of different levels of production and suspension of authority, especially leadership strategies of teachers, such as prior plannings, as seating arrangements or setting up rules or things like that. Also authorizations in the sense of implicit and as well as explicit expressions of solidarity and resistance by the pupils. And negotiation of imagination, so such as reputance of teachers, for example, strictness or expectations of the pupils and expected obedience, things like that. In this study or this context, the pointed questions emerge: who is produced as a disruption or support? And therefore I looked at favorite pupils as well as conspicuous cliques such as cool boys or girls who are very important for the implementation of institutional intentions. And the inconspicuous children who were often read by the teachers or perceived by the teachers as supporters, and finally by the troublemakers such as clowns. And it was not reconstructed who is a disturbance or support, but how someone became such. And so especially in the situation, which I will read out loud in the next part, there is the teacher use kind of an her authority. She's doing an doing authority because she feels herself as vulnerable somehow, and I will try to work out how she what is maybe the her conception of Fabrizio and the scenario. So I will read out the scene. In a frontal teaching situation, the homework is reviewed. The process is that one pupil after the other is called following the seating arrangement. After Timo was called, it is Fabrizio's turn. Fabrizio looks up from his workbook. He had previously reported that he did not do the houses short term for homework. The homework was about several words and their origin. For example, driving tests have to be assigned one of the root terms of number, feel, or drive. So here it won't make sense so much. It's somehow the German grammar structure which you have to understand, and the example is translated. Mrs. Wagner says very quickly, "No, even if you didn't do it at home, you can do it anyway. The voice goes down, she speaks like with a little child. You can still sing, right? Where are we? Fabrizio, at which? What comes after pay? Which word, Fabrizio? Third row, last word. Fabrizio keeps looking at his notebook and seems to be searching. Tim says, oh no. Mrs. Wagner, very loud and angry. Third row, last word. Read it now, immediately. Hello, Mrs. Wagner looks constantly at Fabrizio. The class is focused on him. Jacob says, annoyed, oh. Mrs. Wagner, you realize that everyone is waiting for you? Fabrizio seems paralyzed. Liz claps her hand on her face and moans. Mrs. Wagner, can you open your mouth now so we know what's wrong? You cannot get out of this. You will answer the question or just read the word. Timur, can you show him where we are at? Mrs. Wagner asks Timur, Fabrizio's neighbor, which word are we at? Timur points to the bottom of the word book. There are, however, only the words already entered. Fabrizio side follows Timo's hand. He does not comment. He looks shyly at Mrs. Wagner. Mrs. Wagner, third row, do you know what a row is? A line. So from the words standing there, third line, third word, or it rolls through the class. Mrs. Wagner, is there nothing in your yo-yo? So that's the name of the workbook. You, Fabrizio, I think that's a bit weird right now. What you are pulling off right now, and you're not going to do that anymore because you're doing it all the time with me. You are purposely acting stupid. I will not do that. Mrs. Wagner continues. No, please read the word. I'm really freaking out here. Amund, do you know where we are? Amund replies, yes, Mrs. Wagner. Can you show it to him, please? Amund goes to Fabrizio and shows him the answer. Fabrizio follows his hand. Fabrizio reads the word. Mrs. Wagner asks, number, feel, or drive? Fabrizio says very softly, drive. Mrs. Wagner, right, exactly. Where was the problem now? Do you know how to handle it now? Fabrizio nods his head. Mrs. Wagner turns to the next child. The discussion of homework continues. Fabrizio sits in his seat for a long time, gazing at himself. There are tears in his eyes. Only after a few minutes, he looks around again. So before I come to my findings, I will shortly analyze the scene. So in the present scene, Fabrizio announced that he had forgotten his homework. Implicitly, the teacher's non-communicated requirement remained that Fabrizio should still take care of the homework control and solve the task. And maybe she calls on him to check whether he's listening. Despite several instructions, Fabrizio doesn't solve the task. And I guess she's somehow exhausts Fabrizio massively in front of the classroom, because maybe she thinks of the next homework correction and somehow wants to set an example on him. What is somehow, yeah, heavy is this kind of prehistory, which is embedded in you are doing it all the time with me. And this is, vice versa, reciprocally, because Fabrizio also says nothing at this situation and he's only paralyzed. He isn't really talking too much, just says shyly something. And Fabrizio, or no, more the Mrs. Wagner isn't pretty much intervening when the audience is normalizing Fabrizio's gestures and comportment, and she also says that you are purposely acting stupid, and yeah, you can read it as an implicit compliment, because if somebody is purposely acting stupid, he could be clever, but it's a situation he cannot show how that he has a potential or something. And so then she's saying things like, I'm freaking out here, and yeah, I will, in the following part, I will argue about weaker pupils and somehow the respected one. What is important, that Fabrizio is submissively acting, and he is answering correctly in the end, even though it's a bit weird that she's asking him if he's understanding it now. At the reflection of the year, he says that he isn't doesn't like to come to school, and there is a relation to a potential exclusion, because he will get grades for only the lower secondary school. And this is coupled with a low socioeconomic background of his family, which is not mentioned in the scene. So we have to be aware that it's somehow also a construction, but as it comes up often, this pattern, I think, and maybe you could come to the next slide, Kevin, that there is a structural level. So I argue in this paper, Kevin already mentioned, that the judgment of teachers should be displayed, accepted. If there is a neglecting of authoritative action is read as an undoing authority, and here the teacher feels that her authority is undone, and then this implies a huge vulnerability, which is related to a restaging of social inequalities. At least I could show two directions, that a performed respect is associated with good pupils and regulates the conditions of recognitions, with a high degree of vulnerability as it depends on mutual recognition, and a performed degradation, which we can much more find in this scene, I guess, which is associated with bad pupils and structures both present and future exclusions, and can become a pattern of reciprocal pathological injury. And I guess this injury we could see in this scene. I'm freaking out here. Senses like this, we could maybe understand in this sense. I argue that exclusion in classroom was constituted in these kind of conflicts, and that there are homologies between exclusion, transitional recommendations, and the socio-special positioning of pupils. Yeah, I think, as I already said, we have to be somehow aware of these kind of construction processes, but I could show some homologies. Maybe so far for the moment, and we come to the discussion. Can you proceed, Kevin? And then we are looking forward to your questions and comments, I guess. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you, Florian. So I'm just going to maybe tie it up and sort of try and tie in a bit also into the earlier part. So I think in taking from the examples that, and I think especially that very telling case study, and the role that authority and the conflict, the conflict that teacher perceived from this student's like a response or for many different reasons. I think there are, the debate can be the reasons for which a student might have difficulties or can be very numerous, can be very factored. But in this case, it became, in some respects, a battle of wills. And I think it is a battle that does damage. And I think that it can be perceived in this example. And the victim of that battle in this case, and in this case, it's just one student. I think that, I don't know about all of you, but I think that these kinds of conflicts between teacher-student, they're actually quite common. This is not something that, and I think that the question of authority plays a very important role in how these conflicts take shape, and also what is permitted. So in our discussions, I'll go a bit into the slide, but in our discussions between Florian and myself, one thing I also was thinking, and that comes to my mind, is that response on the part of that teacher, the reason such responses end up often being acceptable and not completely reprehensible is because teachers occupy a particular position in the school system where that kind of exercise of power is considered to be like a central pedagogical exercise, like it is justified, and that justification comes from the role of the teacher, even though it does real injury. In this case, as we saw to this student, and that brings us then to this question and the argument coming back that in the context of this classroom, I think if we're looking at it interactively, so we can think about social inequalities in many different ways. We can think about them in terms of structural reproductions and all these kinds of questions. I think that this is a good example of how interactive dynamics create and reproduce patterns of inequality in the classroom. And the reason that I think that matters so much is because students from different contexts who have different obstacles entering the classroom, in these kinds of situations where the student might or might not be treated with this kind of indignity of different kinds, I think that if we're thinking, for example, towards Bourdieu and the way that Bourdieu talks about the reproduction, often it gets expressed in the person as a, well, that's just not for the likes of me. This is something that Bourdieu said quite a lot in his research, that the way that students of different classes would perceive the schooling process, they would feel like, well, it's just not for people like me. And I think that this dynamic, this example, is I think an example of how that actually takes place, how they are told in the classroom through different processes, that this is not the place for you. You don't seem to be up to the task. And I think that in this case, the question of authority is a central part of how that happened. So in this example, I think it gives a good example of exactly how monological authority is. So there really is not trust in this dynamic. The dynamic is one that's much more characterized by obstruction and a challenge. So the directive ended up becoming a conflict, and that conflict was basically born majoritarily by this student. And I think that so just to tie that back in, as I had said, it's sort of an example of the micro processes that take place in how social inequalities sometimes function. And I think that in understanding both the vulnerability of the student, but also like this teacher's response here was also very much one of vulnerability, and the teacher was frustrated, obviously, and that emotion. And so I think the question also ends up having to be, so we're talking here about vulnerability, but I think it's important to talk about the emotional in education, like how do we confront, how do we engage, and how do we justify particular types of emotional responses as being valid or invalid? And I think that they're very important types of questions if we want to make schooling more socially just. We have to talk about the emotional dynamics that contribute to inequalities and also privileges. Like there are certain kinds of emotional responses that are where, for example, a different student might have gotten a much softer treatment for any number of reasons, and that is also a privileged experience. And so I think that it sort of provides a window into exclusions and exclusions and how authority gets performed in the classroom. And that is our presentation.
Thank you so much. I wonder if we can stop the thank you. Right. Really interesting presentation. I was left with a couple of questions, mostly of certain elements that you spoke about, perhaps more like background information. For example, if you could explain a little bit more of that German system of education and the different tracks. And you, Florian, you mentioned that you had investigated the process of putting different students in the different groups, but maybe a little bit more background information as to how that works in Germany, while people get their questions put together and prepared.
Yeah, thank you for the question. So especially the third grade is important for the divisions in certain tracks. So to become a grammar school pupil, the grades in first and second class are also important, but at the third so and it depends also a bit the lender and we have a federal system, so it's not always the same, but in the south and middle of Germany, where as Baden-Württemberg and Nordrhein-Westfalen, so where I conducted my research, there was a third grade very important, and they were looking at mathematics and German, and especially these two subjects were important to get a certain recommendation. For example, the grammar or Realschule and so on. So, and this was why I thought, okay, it yeah, the most how can I frame it? Every pupil come together in the primary school, and then they are selected by gradings and also by the performance in the classroom at the second and third grade. And so I started in the beginning of the third year. So when the pupils were 9 years old, with my observations. So.
Right. Thank you so much for those clarification. As I see three hands, first in my list is Alina. Then, is it Vasek or Wasek?
It's Wasak. Wasak.
Wasak.
Yes.
And Wasak. Thank you. And then Sultan.
Yeah, thank you, Florian, and Kevin, so much. This was really interesting. I'm new here, so I'm really glad I'm joining. But briefly, I'm coming actually from the management background, and I'm studying leadership. So this topic of authority is like really prominent to me, and like how you approach it is super interesting. But I wondered, so you talked about the substance ontology and monological authority. I wonder, and you briefly mentioned about this like relational approach. So how would relational approach look like in this case? Like, I kind of wanted to push it a bit further and to see, okay, so how would it look like? What would it contribute? Like, if we do go away from the monological authority and towards this relational approach, how will it look like? Like, what is the contribution there? What it will help us to accomplish, I guess.
Absolutely. I think that, I didn't touch too extensively because I didn't want to make the presentation too long, and I wanted to properly establish the context of Florian's study. I think that a relational, obviously it's really the more interesting in terms of, so it's one thing to critique, but then what can we do? I think that a relational conception of authority. I don't want to say go too far in my claim in this regard, but I think that there are versions of relational authority and relational approaches to authority in very many of the social justice education thinkers. So Paulo Freire, bell hooks, Gert Biesta is someone who I mentioned in this, but he also has extensive work on, and it may not necessarily be explicitly framed, although it often is. It may not necessarily be explicitly framed as leadership, but it has to do with, I think, because the challenge, I think, with a relational view is that we end up in a, once you sort of think of a relationship, like learning relationship dialogically, which is the way maybe Paulo Freire would frame it, then the question does become how do you create the circumstance for the symmetry of power in the classroom, for example. And I think in the classroom, it's a challenging question because there is knowledge that does need to be, someone does have an expertise. And so to say that people are equal does not necessarily mean they have the same experience. And I think what a relational view can do in so many contexts and in so many ways is that it can offer, I think, us a way of rethinking the core relationships in education. So for example, the teacher and the student, the idea that teachers are tasked with a job to, I don't want to overly simplify, but I often think this ends up being how teaching is about instruction, and instruction is about tests, and it's about ensuring that a student is qualified, and all of these things are important, but they're very much technocratic at the base. They're about what kinds of techniques, and the question about the nature of our relations, the nature, like for instance, what do we owe one another, what should we, I think this is something that a relational approach automatically, you have to think about the nature of your relationship, the nature, for instance, of your own process as well. Paulo Freire talks about that teachers have to be themselves learners. And you cannot be a teacher without also assuming that you have something to learn from your student, because then the educational relationship ends up being something non-educational. It ends up being, he calls it ideology or oppression. That is what it is, indoctrination when it is a one-way street. And so there ends up being quite a few rather significant social justice implications from a relational way of thinking, not just about authority, but about, I think, leadership, just interactivity, intersubjectivity is the way Gert Biesta talks about that idea. And so, yeah, does that speak to the question?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.
I just Thank wanted you. To add maybe oh. one short idea, because I thought here is kind of an injury, I guess, on the part of the teacher, and a relational approach could think of, okay, how could I read Fabrizio as someone new I can learn from, as you mentioned already, Kevin, so that the teachers can learn something from the pupils as well, and being open for his perspective, because he could have maybe good reasons why he wasn't able to answer, and so on. So like getting a view and perspective, being open, and maybe question. Yeah, ask questions, things like that could mean to be like relational in this kind of context. And this could be also a exclusion process, or maybe, to rebuild a relation where you could learn again. Because I argue also that there are some pupils who haven't anymore an option to learn from the teachers, because when there is such an injury, then it's difficult to get to certain points of learn again from each other and to, yeah, to give them insights what could be helpful for them and so on. So yeah, a certain kind of openness would be my ad. So a long ad, sorry.
Thank you so much. No, it's really good. And thank you so much for that question, Alina, which really puts this study more in a more interdisciplinary lens, and so appreciated. Just I'm in a higher education environment as a teacher. That's all my experience, really, and looking at this examples. And right now I'm in a position more or less of administrative leadership. So also thinking about this, how do you get this into a more relational, empowering to those who are in the receiving end of, for example, discipline? So maybe we can think about that together. Sorry, I see Washak's hand. Did I say that right, Washak?
Yes.
Oh, yay, thank you.
Right.
Go ahead, please.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, Kevin and Florian. I really like Kevin's foregrounding of the concept. It makes it very accessible for people who are not from the field. And thank you, Florian, for the rich fieldwork. And then it feels like we are there with the pupils, and then the pain and the humiliation that is felt very much in this webinar. I have you don't have to answer everything, because I feel that I'm coming from political science and then also doing indigenous studies. So it's kind of just blundering through. So you can choose something, or if there's something that's useful, I'll be very happy. But I'm just trying to share.
That's how it happens. You blunder through.
Right. Thank you. So I have four short points. The first one is that I want to know more the results of this paper's relevance to the higher education institutes. Like, does it help us to resist technocratic measures with college students who are doing their undergraduate, graduate? Because I'm going to design syllabus, and then I feel that there's a very strong emphasis on testing and technocratic organization management. So yeah, I think it would be really cool if these results could have relevance to higher education institute. Second, results relevance to policymaking. So coming from political science, and I'm also focusing on the truth and reconciliation process in Taiwan in terms of indigenous resurgence. So I would be thinking that this relational approach would be so much useful if the policymakers are taking more to that direction rather than this monological authority. So how do we try to push it to that direction? And I'm speaking from doing research in aging and care in indigenous communities. So it has generated a lot of moral injuries, stress on the indigenous elders and indigenous workers, because they are not doing according to the state authority. So how do we negotiate that? So that's the second point. And the third point is how, so methodologically, I think it is a very cool innovation, and I want to know more about the, how is this methodology different from the previous methodologies in researching authority or relational authority? What does it add, like this current methodology? And fourthly, I feel very strongly of the field notes, because I also do ethnographic research. So the field notes really reminded me of my Finnish language education here in Finland. I have been trying to learn Finnish for the past 10 years. And I remember how humiliating it is when the teachers are saying basically the same as the Mrs. Hubert, saying that you need to read this and nobody knows what to read, and then feel very sad. And then I feel that they put a lot of responsibility on the pupils rather than on the teachers. So I think there is this underlying of that you did not learn because you did not try. But then when learning did not happen, whose problem is this? Does this paper tell us more about teasing out more nuance of teaching and learning dynamic? And also, like Florian said, so this is the last point, sorry for taking so much time. So showing the exclusion and humiliation and this bad pedagogy, that I think it is a very bad pedagogy. And it reminded me of maybe it will be something relevant, because in Finnish government program, they have been promoting this inclusivity. So the idea is you need to include all the students in the classroom. And because there is no official guideline or strategy of how to implement inclusivity, so they basically just mix all the students of different level of needs, but this leads to teachers having over burnout and having overwork to try to maintain the classroom order in order to really let learning happen. So I think that would be also the other side of inclusivity. So it's not just like exclusivity that will make bad pedagogy, but maybe inclusivity will also, if you didn't do it right. But thank you so much for the presentation. Sorry for taking so much time.
It's all good.
Thank you for your numerous questions. Florian, I don't know if there are any that you wanted to maybe jump in on. And
Maybe I can jump into the third one and then we can think of the rest, because I saw from the methodology we could combine policy making and maybe also afterwards implications somehow. Would that be in?
I thought those three also could be, yeah.
How is it new? I really was like stuck by this kind of very emotional situations where it comes to shame, or maybe shame, it's not that clear, but as Fabrizio acts in this kind of situations, it is pretty possible, I guess. So I guess the innovation somehow is to try to work out the emotional part in this kind of contexts of negotiation of authority. And there is often, as I framed it, a red of an undoing of authority. It's not that the teacher wants to that he's clear that he isn't reading Mrs. Wagner as not an authority in the situation, but she, or often the teachers, read the behavior of the pupils as that. And I guess that's pretty much important, because they feel, and this is maybe a bit connected to the fourth part as well, because teachers feel, as Kevin mentioned before, and also vulnerable, and several times I argue that they attack them, the pupil, and externalize these kind of problems, which are maybe in the relation, and only argue that the pupil is the one who's in charge, and that's part of the problem, I guess. So we have to re-embed it in this kind of, and this is maybe the one. Is it okay, Kevin, when I step further? Because I thought it's also connected to your first question, the results are the higher education processes. Because I guess the most risk is to stay in an openness when it comes to conflicts, when there is like these kind of situations where somebody don't know, or where you maybe need kind of an openness to hold the uncertainty, and so these kind of context we have to train somehow, maybe teachers as well, to get like conflict competencies or kind such a thing. And this might be also something which could be interesting in the sense of to argue in policy context, because I guess we are living times where you have to navigate conflicts, and this, that would be my answering way. Kevin, what I bet you have some other ideas as well. No?
Well, my take would be coming from the last point about inclusivity and efficiency, and I think it connects actually to many of the other in different respects, but. I think that the question about, for example, educational policy, the implications for higher education, I think that sometimes the challenge we face with questions around inclusion, for example, is that the inclusive movement is itself, so I'm going to try and tie it back to our big theme, but inclusion today is still being forwarded in a neoliberal environment. And the neoliberal environment is so in a sense, the way we talk about inclusion tends to be talked about under the umbrella of individualization. And so who has to be inclusive? Teachers. How do we get teachers to be inclusive? And how do we get, and so we put the problem on the people who are already overwhelmed and overburdened. And I think that the way that I think of relational theory and the relational idea of authority in this respect, it's difficult to conform to that model, because relationalism it's not about responsibilizing individuals. It's very, very easily becomes that all the time, because when we say, well, what can we do? We tend to think about what can we do in terms of how do we get a teacher to be more inclusive. But I don't think that that's necessarily the right question. I think that the reason we ask that question is because we remain concerned with efficiency. If we were not so concerned with efficiency, then inclusion is about removing some of the some of the more onerous expectations, not to say that the quality necessarily, but we just accept that we make an exchange in terms of livability and well-being for taking off all of the fact that everything is so meticulously looked at today. And so the fact that everything is so accounted for is in part because we want everything to be productive and to make every dollar count in the way that, and so the way that I'm thinking, so if we're going back to higher education implications and curriculum and all of those things, I think that what it would ultimately maybe look like is a more local based negotiation of learning objectives, of the way, it's very hard to standardize these aspects in education, because I think, if we're, for instance, if we're really serious about the idea of authority being something that a child has in the classroom, then they should also have the ability to say no to certain kinds of, and that should be something that we can be like, well, maybe that's okay. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's kind of a big, the way that I talk to my students, at least in my courses, is I'm always trying to push the idea that there are structural realities that make these things very difficult to actually pursue. But most of the time, the things we struggle with today in education come from the structural problems that we talk about exclusion and inclusion, but we very rarely see people who are explicitly excluding other people intentionally. And if we were to bring it up, it's often like, oh, I didn't intend it. But the system itself is very exclusive in so many respects. The people that have access to higher education tend to be socioeconomically advantaged. And that's actually a real problem, you know? And so I think, yeah, relationalism brings a lot of these kinds of reflections. Yeah.
Thank you so much for those answers to very, very great questions. I'm also still thinking about those, Vashak. I am seeing a very dynamic screen there, Sultan. It's moving around a little bit, so maybe that's
can you hear me okay nonetheless?
I think so, yeah, we can.
So the audio feed is not as choppy as the video?
Not
the
at all.
The audio is so fine.
The video is beyond my control.
That's all right. Okay, that's how I say. Amplifies our dynamic.
Okay, so one comment and a question, and let me preface my comment with the following, that we in Hungary are pretty much familiar with the German education system, because ours is based on the German system. It's inherited from the dual monarchy, you know, Austria-Hungary, from the early to mid 19th century. In my own case, I literally went to a high school called Realschule, literally located in a street downtown Budapest, named Realschule, and it's still bilingual high school, German-Hungarian, so I'm pretty much familiar. And by the way, the homework in Hungarian is called Hausi, like in Germany. And still, as part of a preface, whenever Hungarians criticize their own education system, they very often use the word, it's a Prussian style, Prussian with a P, Prussian being a shorthand for authoritarian. So I'm pretty much familiar with, you know, all this willingness to humiliate students in class and so on and so on. And turning to my comment, let me praise two countries. The first is Finland, the second is Canada. In Finland, you know, there's a lot of media praising of Finland for achieving especially high scores in the what is the international ranking called? PISA? Yeah, it's PISA. They tend to achieve very high scores. And actually, a friend of mine who has been living in Finland for like 20 years, and that's they send their kids to finish elementary school, and I was amazed to learn that in the Finnish education system, I'm not sure if it's general, but I guess it must be general, because it is highly egalitarian and it's universal and it's pretty simple. They don't teach young kids how to read. What they do is simply they teach them the letters, and what these young kids do, they end up learning how to read themselves by figuring out how to put together words, and the teachers that they just don't bother teaching them how to read. And you know, when you were reading your field notes, it almost brought tears to my eyes, because I remember how a lot of teachers barely into my early school years, around my age of 7, 8, how the effort teachers were putting in into humiliating students who were struggling with reading. So no humiliation whatsoever in the Finnish system when it comes to reading. And this makes reading all the more interesting, because it is done against any outsider will, if you see what I'm getting at. Okay, so the second comment would be the Canadian education system, especially in terms of bilingualism, because the way foreign languages are taught in the quote unquote Prussian, or I would go as far as calling it continental European education system, is by kind of this authoritarian style, rote learning oriented approach. And this is very successful in making students uninterested in learning foreign languages. Whereas, and by the way, we all the time in Hungary get corrected for errors when in foreign language classrooms. And as far as I'm aware, I'm pretty much familiar with a lot of things Canadian. I have family in Canada, Ottawa. And what they tell me on a regular basis is that it's more natural in a Canadian classroom setting. For example, I have this uncle who sent both of the kids to bilingual schools in Ottawa, French and English. And there's hardly, I mean, from what I've gathered over the years, is there's hardly any effort put into correcting grammatical, you know, things, and it's made more natural. They don't feel awkward, and so on and so on. So to the question, would you say that this Finnish approach, not teaching students how to read, at least in the traditional sense, or the Canadian approach to making students immersed in bilingualism. These are relational approaches to education. Would you agree with this characterization?
So to the best of my ability, in terms of the Finnish context, I think whether it's relational or not, it's difficult to say. What I would be willing to say is that it's maybe less of a outcome based orientation. It's more of a process based, practice based, negotiated type of learning. Which I know that is in Finland, there among other approaches in education, there is at least a value for these things. What I will say in Canada, and the example that you gave Zoltan about language, I think Ottawa is actually probably the place where that bilingualism is the most pronounced and the most normalized. So I am in a French language environment in Quebec City, and in Quebec City we. I mean, English is always a little bit of a specter. it's less of an inclusive thing, and I think that even in Canada, all of these questions about justice and inclusion and all of those processes, different provinces have very different experiences too. It's very important to sort of know that side of it.
I wonder if we've got, I'm just looking at the time and I see that we've got 8 minutes left in this session. I don't want to prolong it too much, but I do have Iowith, and please correct me if I am pronouncing your name wrong, Iowith, and go ahead with your question. We have another question in the chat that Serena posed. So, and those are interesting things. So, yeah, what Kevin is saying, education is a provincial jurisdiction in Canada. So I don't, it's just for Sultan's question, I and praise, it would probably be praising,
Ontario.
Ottawa, Ontario. Yeah. There we go. Iowa.
Hi. I'm also new. So I also feel the sense of a cloud of thoughts rather than a line, maybe, but I love all of this conversation, and it's a really central interest of mine, authority and the ways that we can actually make these tangible differences for people that remove harms immediately from their experiences. So I'm really inspired. I just wanted to say I'm inspired by the work that you're doing to address this, and just to offer, and my background is in education in my master's degree, and I actually worked quite closely in a teacher training program. And one thing that I was constantly noting is that there are these kinds of ways of modeling teaching in the classroom, but there isn't this sense of like searching for your particular sort of intangible skills as a person in having relational dynamics occur, which will become these sort of deeply embedded relationships that you have with students that you build over time. And I feel like in my own experience in education, that I've had interpersonal dynamics with people who outside of the classroom also have problems with other people. Like when you go and complain about a teacher you don't like, and everyone's like, oh, them, you know, like even their colleagues. So like, I think sometimes the relational difficulties that we can have as people, and of course we're just people in all the situations that we're in. So like these people problems that we have, I think they span so much further than the educational context. If we're thinking about culture wars, we're thinking about how people deal with people of different political motivations, how we deal with disinformation, like how do we have these conversations that are instructive and that are co-creating a shared reality if we aren't able to have a basic conversation where we're not overtaking the other person or demeaning them or debasing them when we ourselves feel frightened about our own position, our own sense of grounding, right? Like where do you draw the source of that grounding from as you're facing this conflict? And I think in my own attempts to be the kind of person who can work in a horizontal way with others, you know, it's taken years to deconstruct some of that baggage and anxiety. When I come up with someone with a really different approach, you know, we can still really butt heads. And so recently I've been looking into there's this interesting book on nanopolitics, and there's some interesting work happening in theater exercises, especially with the rich tradition of theater of the oppressed. It's just been such a powerful model for my friends and I to try to work through our own pedagogical approaches, as well as I think it really does also apply in the kind of research that we're doing. In having a good conversation with a research subject, the quality of information that you might be getting is going to be, to some extent, precipitated by your kind of vibe, or just the way you make people feel and how open they automatically feel with you and how much they trust you. And all of that is in this really delicate and detailed work in how you approach them and how you even think about the other person and how what they mean to you. And so I found the Theater of the Oppressed work, and we do some work with Theater for Life. I've done some, this is like more out there, like hippie stuff, but like authentic relation or nonviolent communication. I think they have problematic aspects, I will say that. Really, yes. But like, I don't know. I'm searching for something as well as like, what is the actual grounded work of creating a horizontal relation? I think, yeah.
Thank
I don't
you.
Know.
No, I think that was an excellent contribution, and I'm just seeing the time and hoping Kevin and Florian will be okay with me just closing off with a couple of comments. Is that okay? Because you did pose a bunch of questions for us to keep thinking about it. Luckily, we're going to keep meeting every month. The next meeting is in November 17th, so not in a month, but we have to move this one around. In November 17, we're going to be tackling more directly discussions on reflexivity and objectivity. And that session is going to be led by Melody DeVree, Kevin, that has been talking here today, and also Sultan. So I invite everyone to bring your questions and your points. Serena's point was on the inclusivity in the classroom and people who are neurodiverse, right? And as I was reading this, and how can we use this approach to help us out with this? And I would say, as I was reading it, and also thinking about inclusivity, and you mentioned there the theory of the oppressed, and also just being inclusive with the most vulnerable relational subjects, how do we use this approach to engage in that work also in other different levels? And here, well, my work is about processes of racialization, but, you know, being gendered and sexualized and having diverse abilities, like Serena was mentioning there. All of this have a bearing, and not only in the classroom, of course, from this approach. Elena was talking about management and leadership, and I just really appreciate everyone's input and this idea of approaching these issues as people, like you just plainly said, we're people, we're in relation with each other, and not just with each other, but also with the natural environment. And how do we use this approach to engage with all of that? And those are my comments for today, but thank you everyone for joining, and we will meet again in November 17.